Hi there, I'm Nicolas Turpot, and I'm going to present you the paper Training Sound Event Detection on a Heterogeneous Dataset. This work has been made with Romain Cerizet, and we are both at INRIA. So this paper has a context inside the DKS community, of course. But DKS community is very large. We have analysis on urban sounds, animal sounds. We try to do audio captioning. We try to do sound libraries. But here, we are focusing on domestic sounds and especially sound event detection. So the applications are home assisted living, smart home, or security, for example. With Romain, we are organizers of DKS Task 4 since 2018. This task is in a domestic environment and we try to match real conditions with YouTube and Vimeo videos. The goal is to do sound event detection. We have to use semi-supervised learning because we have only a small amount of labeled data. But of course, we can gather a lot of videos on the internet, so we have a lot of unlabeled data. We have weekly supervised learning because the labels that we have are at clip level and are not at frame level. We have a domain mismatch because we have introduced since 2019 synthetic data. The goal of this data is to be strongly labeled data, so that's the advantage. The inconvenient is the fact that they are not exactly in the same domain as the real data. So we have to do some kind of adaptation. This year, in 2020, we introduced sound separation. But there is another paper that Romain is presenting at the poster session. It's called Improving Sound Event Detection in Domestic Environments Using Sound Separation. And I invite you to go see his presentation. The motivation behind this paper is the fact that many submissions, and even us, while designing the baseline, we use previous methods without questioning the impact of each technical choice. So here, we will do an ablation study on the baseline to check the impact of the combination of a heterogeneous dataset, the impact of data augmentation. Unfortunately, I won't have time to present it here, but you can see it in the paper. The impact of noise as input of the mean-teacher model and the impact of ramp-up on the training of the mean-teacher model. Let's begin by describing the baseline. This baseline is a bit complicated since it's using a mean-teacher model. It has been introduced by a participant 2 years ago, and we used it because it was first of the challenge. What we have is three datasets, one weakly labeled, one strongly labeled, and one unlabeled. These sets will be discussed as how we use them, if we use them equally or not. In this model, what we want to train is the student model. To train this model, we use a simple classification method when we have weakly labeled data and strongly labeled data. We have one cost for weakly labeled data and one cost for strongly labeled data. The importance of mean teacher is especially for unlabeled data, even if it also helps for weakly labeled and strongly labeled data to have a consistency cost. For unlabeled data, what we have is like we give an input to the student model and the same input with a bit of noise to the teacher model, and we take the prediction of the teacher model as label to the student model. So we try to match the two predictions here. To do so, we have a strong consistency cost and a weak consistency cost. All these costs will be combined. The student model, his weights are updated with the costs by gradient descent, but the teacher model, his weights are defined by an exponential moving average of the student weights. I invite you to check the paper of mean teacher to understand a bit more the concept. As I said before, here we will try to know the impact of the heterogeneous dataset, then the impact of noise, and then the impact of ramp-up. The impact of data augmentation that you can see in the paper is about pitch shifting and reverberation. So let's begin with heterogeneous dataset. What we want to know is how we combine them and how it's interesting for the training. So since we have three sets, we are combining them in the batch. So in each batch, we will have each data from each set. Of course, we choose the number depending of a ratio of how much we want weakly labeled data or strongly labeled data or unlabeled data. In the experiment, we will vary this ratio RS, RU, and RW here. So here are the results of our experiment. We tried to use all the sets equally chosen. That's our baseline. So we had 34.14% of F-score. Then we try only synthetic data, only weak data, for example, and we have seen that most of the time we have a huge degradation of performance, meaning that each of the sets are very important to combine them. As you can see on the last column, the most important data sets are actually the synthetic and weakly labeled data, because we already have 31%. So the information brought by the unlabeled data is small, but still it's important. Let's now talk about the noise added on the teacher input. It's this lambda that we can see here on the figure. What we did is like we tried to vary the SNR of this noise from 0 to 30 dB and also one without noise. Surprisingly, in these experiments, we saw that having no noise is beneficial, and the more we add noise, the more it degrades the performance. And very heavily, for example, when we have a noise of 0 dB, we have only 12.56% of F-score. This is what we explained at the beginning of the motivation of this paper, is the fact here, we made a choice based on what the participant did, but it's actually not the best solution to do this. The idea behind that, the explanation that we can have about the fact that the noise is degrading the performances, is the fact that the teacher model has already a different dropout than the student model. So there is already the noise that is added on the weights. So adding notes to the input is not beneficial. But of course, this hasn't been checked, so there is more work to check this hypothesis. Let's now talk about the ramp-up. The idea behind the ramp-up is to vary the parameters during time. So what we will vary is the importance of each cost during the training process or on the learning rate. The idea is, the concept is very easy to understand for the consistency cost, for example, is the fact that at the beginning of the training, we don't have, the teacher model is really not well, the student and the teacher model are not well trained. So trying to have a consistency between them is not very beneficial, and the teacher output here would be also not good at all. So trying to do a consistency between two things that are not good at all will always won't be very interesting. So if we wait some epochs while the student is a bit more trained, then we will have like better predictions, and having the consistency would be more beneficial for the training. So we would have to wait some epochs to do that. So that's why we use a ramp-up. Here are the experiments of the impact of the ramp-up. So what we tried is to do ramp-up on the consistency cost. So it means the weight that we put in front of the consistency cost. So then the classification cost and the consistency cost don't have the same weight. Or the ramp-up on the learning rate. So this is the consistency cost and LR for learning rate. What you see on the third row, the consistency weight, it means what is the value of the consistency weight when we don't use ramp-up, and when we use ramp-up, it goes to 0 to 2 in the 50 first epochs. So as you can see, having a good consistency cost, so having a good weight on the consistency cost, for example, going from 1 to 2 is beneficial. Doing only the ramp-up on the consistency cost makes actually a bit degrades a bit the performance between having a consistency cost always the same, a consistency weight always the same of 2. Doing ramp up on the learning rate only with a consistency cost of 1, we have 31% of F-score. So this means the ramp up of the learning rate is very important, because you can see the gap between the experiments without the ramp up on learning rate and the one with the ramp up on the learning rate. So this is very important to do that. Then we can see that the consistency cost, the consistency weight, improve a bit the performances, and we have the best performance when we combine actually the ramp ups on the consistency cost and the learning rate. So this choice was a good choice, and it is kept in the final baseline. So to conclude, we've seen the importance to use all the data sets and a good balance between them. Data augmentation is tricky, and in our case, it was more useful at validation time than training. This is the conclusion that we had in the paper, but I will put it here in case you're interested. Reverb and pitch shifting are combined at validation. When reverb and pitch shifting were combined at validation, it was worse than only one of them used. Training without noise as input of the teacher model is better. As I said before, it's probably because of the dropout used. And then ramp up is very useful, especially on the learning rate, but it's an important piece in the mean teacher model. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask them in the chat.
Yeah.